As was mentioned, I'm Dr. Clifton Langdon, Assistant Director for the Brain Language Lab, collaborating with Dr. Petitto, the Science Director for BL2. Our lab was established in 2011, and since its inception, has rapidly grown. We now have a lab manager, a postdoc research assistant, and me as the assistant director. We also have doctoral students from the PhD in Educational Neuroscience, also known as PEN. Along with the PEN students, we've had a mixture of both graduate and undergraduate students. Since 2011, we've had a number of people be part of our team, as you see before you on this screen. BL2 poses deep questions about human cognition and human learning in three domains. We research basic questions about how humans learn languages. Through posing these questions, we hope to understand more about human cognition and its role in language acquisition. Language acquisition acts as a foundation for the further questions that we ask about bilingualism and acquiring languages in different contexts. Finally, building upon that foundation, we will explore more about how one learns to read. To research these questions in innovative ways, we have been able to leverage the use of innovative technologies, such as EFNIR's neuroimaging or functional near-infrared spectroscopy. Using this technology allows us to capture the neural systems and networks involved in the cognitive processes for language, reading, emotion, etc. The EFNIR's system allows us to explore these questions with a number of different populations that we would be unable to explore using other methods. For example, we can study newborn infants that are just a few hours old to see what the infant brain is primed for in language acquisition. And we can move from this all the way up to senior citizens to give us information about the entire lifespan. Not only this, we can also study other special populations, such as those who have cochlear implants or metal in their bodies. In addition to the ability to study across ages, the NERS system is portable, allowing us to study these same questions in different contexts, like in the laboratory or in the field. Eye tracking allows us to understand more about attention and where we allocate attention. We are also able to use this remotely, which allows us to investigate in a non-invasive way. In addition to these two innovative technologies, we're also using thermal infrared imaging. These cameras allow us to measure skin temperature. We want to capture this information because we can infer emotional states and level of engagement. Beyond these technologies, we are also working in partnership with other labs that have expertise in robotics and avatars. In addition to that, we're partnering with the ML2 lab, which you'll be hearing more about later this evening. So these are the different technologies that we use in our laboratory. Language acquisition is an important domain. Babies are born with the challenge of acquiring any language in the world, whether that be spoken or signed, English, Chinese, or Finnish. When infants are born, they experience language as a continuous stream. They're not given a textbook to tell them what one segmented unit of the language looks like or sounds like. So how do they do it? They're not born knowing Finnish. That's Finnish on the screen here, by the way. All the spaces between the words have been removed. So here, just as you don't know where a word starts and ends, babies don't know either. This is the language acquisition challenge they face. We know that infants begin addressing this challenge by segmenting on the phonological level. Think of the phonological level as something like a letter unit or something around that scale. So if they're beginning with segmenting these phonological units like syllables, this is a clue for us that there is something important about this level of language. There are particular rhythms and patterns that infants are attuned to. Dr. Petitto's prior research examined how the brains of both deaf and hearing children process the incoming stream of language, whether signed or spoken, and what areas of the brain might be involved in that. Her findings show that the brain recruits identical sites and systems to process phonological units, regardless of whether they are signed or spoken. That tells us that the brain is not looking for a particular sign or a particular kind of speech, but rather some underlying aspect of language. This is the means by which babies enter the world and immediately begin to acquire language. We want to investigate that. How are they doing it? One key clue is found in the fact that when one is engaging with infants, there is a linguistic pattern of 1.5 syllables per second. That seems to be the natural rhythm that infants use to break down the language stream. We're now using our systems, the FNIRS, thermal imaging, and eye tracking systems, all in an integrated manner to answer these questions. Early results tell us that infants have a sensitivity for detecting linguistic patterns at 1.5 hertz, or 1.5 times per second. This seems to be the answer in how babies segment the linguistic stream, like this example on the screen. Bilingualism is another important domain of inquiry, with many important associated questions. People often ask, should children be exposed to two languages simultaneously, or instead first master one language before being exposed to the other? The scientific findings from our lab show clearly that early exposure is far better. Despite the fact that these children can't even tie their shoes yet, they will not be as overwhelmed as you might think. Instead, there is a biological maturation timeline. In early life, their brains are ready for language acquisition. Another question is whether it makes any difference if the child is deaf or hearing. The answer is no. The important thing is that the child can access a language-rich environment. Does it make a difference whether the language is signed or spoken? No. As I just mentioned, the brain responds the same way to either one. What if the child gets one signed plus one spoken language, or two signed languages, or two spoken languages? Will it make any difference? Again, the brain will acquire the language. The important thing is that they get the early exposure. Now, we wonder, how are young children learning to read? Young children are seeing these squiggly lines on a page, and they're mapping their language onto this writing system to make it meaningful. But how are they doing this? There has been a lot of research into this question, and one key finding is that children use phonology to break down the patterns in the writing system. So again, phonology plays an important role for reading. This research into how spoken languages help children learn to read tells us phonology is important, but that makes us wonder, is this benefit only for spoken language phonology? Our findings say no. In fact, we find that children can use what is called visual sign phonology. When children receive early sign language exposure, they are given tools that allow them to segment language input and detect patterns in printed words. Our lab's findings are revealing to us the power and importance of early language exposure. Thank you.